So, we are going to proceed with the next talk in this room, AOE. And you're going to listen to innovations in the CMS market. And please give a hand to Alain, who is going to present.
So, yeah, hello everyone. I'm not going to talk about innovation, not really, but I'm going to take a little journey about why I think the CMS industry needs a fundamental shift. So if you come here, or you have come here, and are expecting a talk about Type 3 CMS or any other CMS, you're completely wrong. We're talking about the CMS industry in the next 30 minutes, and why, of my opinion, we need a fundamental shift. So, welcome everyone. Maybe you know me already. I'm Alain Veuve. I am a manager of AOE Switzerland at the moment, doing other stuff for AOE as well. And in my Type 3 sort of life, I am a member of the board. I'm the treasurer of the Type 3 Association, and I'm involved in the Type 3 marketing team. So, just some words about AOE. There might be some guys who do not know AOB already, so we're just one of the biggest open source web software implementers. We are doing international business. We have some great clients all over the world. We are already like 200 people, and that's enough sales talk. So I will not bother you further on with that. So to look into the future, it's always good to step back and have a look back. And that's what I want to start with you today. Let me ask beforehand, who of you is running a web agency? Well, I hoped that would be the case, so that's a great, because I want to talk to you, not to developers, not to clients, to anyone, but really the web agencies. So what I can show you here, is the first web page. One of my companies in my career, I has had several companies. That's the first web page I had. As you can see, I was moving computer hardware. We were quite a small company. It was back in 1999. And we had that sort of web page here. And I can remember that it was very hard to deal with all the content there. There was no CMS behind. And we were quite starting doing business with the website, but most people called us and did their orders via phone. That was the sort of website that was established back then, like 15 years ago. And it was then seen as one of its best kinds, really stylish, really good, and all these kind of things. So if you go back to that time and you want to paraphrase user experience in just one term, then it would be this one. if you had 56 kilobits, you were the lucky ones, didn't you? So that was really great, awesome. And what I want to say about that is that it was really a small game you have to deal with. And websites have been managed all manually, and they were created by tools. And you know, back then, one tool was very important. It was that one. The guy on the left side is a guy called Randy Forgert, who is the main driver behind FrontPage. And the guy on the right, I don't need to explain who this is. This is the one who bought the software and make it bigger. So, I hope I can somehow bring it to you what these kind of times have been. Even Google has been out there. I have to show that. Maybe most of you know that already, but it's really important to know. That's the complete hardware stack that Google was run on in 1999. So, that was the world we're living in, or our world, like the digital world, back in 1999. What was important, or is important for my talk here, is that maintaining websites has been an incredibly tough game. And I don't, I mean, I say that from my experience as being a company owner then, because every time you had to change something on the website, you had to think about what the change should be, send it to the developer. The developer would open front page or whatever tool he used then, do the change, publish it, and rings you up and said, hey, I've done the change. Can you have a look at it? So that has all been dealing with kind of things. And that's why our website was updated like twice a week at maximum. And we were really top notch with that periodism. And at first, nobody cared. No business cared. Because that, back then, the internet was just not important. We have to face it. Our business, I mentioned it already, ran in via fax, really? Ran in via telephone. A lot of people rushed by. We had to have meetings, and the orders went in there. So, and I didn't really care then, back then, about what was on the internet. I mean, we had a website because we needed it to have, but okay, that's it. But then, things changed. And there were two things that really were the drivers behind that change. The one is that there was technology coming in, and the technology of, which I think is one of the main drivers, is the high-speed internet access. What you see here is a chart from Switzerland, but it's kind of representative for all sorts of high-speed internet access development worldwide. What you can see here is that right in the beginning of the last decade, there was a huge curve going up. There was a lot of high-speed internet connections coming in. And there was really a driver behind the whole internet thing. So all of a sudden, or more all of a sudden, new technology was there that enabled people to do so. And it's no wonder that people did. So the second slide is, people are adopting that technology, and they are using that technology. I guess you know that almost 50% of the worldwide citizen has access to the internet, and we are expecting that there are 3 billions by the end of this year. So all of a sudden, the internet got way more important, and it got way more important to companies as well. And there was a lot of pressure coming to companies like ours, because users ask, can I order that online? Can I download the prospectus from the web? Can I configure my machine on the web? Why can't you offer that? Dell does that. I'm going to shop with Dell because you can't offer that. That has been the kind of things that put pressure on me as an entrepreneur in that time. And a lot of other guys in companies felt exactly the same. And then, there was some gift. It was CMS. It was coming in. And I clearly remember the first day when I got served with a CMS with the next website. And luckily, it was a Type 3-based CMS website. I clearly can remember when I first time opened the content element, changed something, saved it, and saw it appear on the web. I mean, that for itself, there was no magic. But the thing is that I was enabled from that day on to heavily do changes on my offering on the web. And what we did then is we did that like every day. We pushed new things there, and the whole web thing instantly developed some sort of magic behind all that. So that was a magic moment for me. And it was talking to so much customers in the last 15 years, for all of them, that was a groundbreaking change in their relation and the way they are doing business on the web or with the web. Back then, it was a relief, to be honest, because it meant reduced cost, it enabled companies to act fast, marketing-wise, communication-wise, and in the end, it produced way better websites for the end users. So That said, anyone who knows me knows I'm liking figures and I'm liking graphs. So I try to figure up the, I paint up a little graph system here, and let me explain that to you. What you see in the green graph is the end user demand, is what people out there, the normal users, citizens, are expecting from websites or digital offerings. The gray graph is a little bit simplified, I admit, is the capability of the CMS industry to deliver on that end user needs and these demands. And the orange one is the benefit for the companies. So going back some slides, some minutes, here it was just not important to anyone because end users did not drive things. Fast internet accesses came in, and we were able to deliver on that. We were able to produce a huge benefit for the customer, and then everyone was happy. And what followed was really a great party. That was the time when I got into the CMS business as well. So, and I think it's a party because the past years we have been living on the growth of the total market, and we all made some sort of good work out of it and made our living out of it. There was an interesting saying from Stefan Wilkomner some weeks ago when we had an agency meetup day in Munich. He said, like, back in these days, when we had that big party, doing business was like dealing with DHL deliveries in the morning, because new projects came in almost like DHL in the morning, and everything you had to do is to make a good job, and you can wait until the next project is coming in. So there was a huge demand, and we had only be able to really deliver on that demand and do things the right way, and we were quite done with it. As a result of that, many of us, have been able to really make a living out of that.
Are you sure my house
now? Yeah, I just wanted to say, you all have been able to build houses, been able to buy cars, some of you have been able to really establish some sort of empire company-wise. I mean, what I want to say is really that we had a good time, and we have been able to live quite a good life, business-wise, personal-wise, on that whole development of our industry and what CMS has brought to us. Again, to show that on the graph system, as long as these three graphs go together in like one line, everything is fine, more or less. And if they go up, it's even fine, because that means the market is still growing. So now it would be a very nice end for the talk. The point is, the world is not standing still, it is changing again. So what happened then? There was mobile coming in. And mobile was a big change, not because of having devices, but because of people have started to use the internet in a completely different way. And by bringing mobile internet devices into their lives, internet affected all of a sudden, like, most all of the spheres and the aspects of life of citizens. Ask yourself, which is a field of your life which is not affected by internet anymore? And it will be very hard to find something that's really not covered or not involved with the internet. So what mobile did is it really changed the way people have been dealing with the internet and have been dealing with technology and their expectation, what they could use as a benefit from all these kind of things. To show you a little bit of a detail, what that means for companies, I picked out retail. You know, retail stores, retail industry, suffering at the moment a little bit with all that pressure. And there's an interesting study, it's quite older, from Google Shopper Marketing Council. And they're saying that 79% of smartphone users are so-called smartphone shoppers. A smartphone shopper, by their definition, is someone who is using the smartphone to do their shopping. Not, that doesn't necessarily mean just order online, but it helps them to get better decisions on their shopping. And more incredibly, another 84 of these smartphone shoppers use their device while being in store, in an offline store, to actually decide on what they should buy or should not buy. So if you compare that situation as it is now to, like, let's say, 7 years ago, it's a complete change, because 8 years from now, most companies, it was not important if there is the internet, because they had great retail stores, they had their customers, they had the experience in the retail stores, and internet was just a niche player. But now, even the guys coming in to the store are using the internet to do their shopping and to do their business. And that has been happening so fast that most of the companies have been completely surprised by that development. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is what has coined out as the digital transformation at the moment, to really face that gap that the companies are lagging behind that development, and that they need to do a development in a quite faster mode than they do in a normal time period for them. So that was just a little bit of an example of what mobile did. It was not about having the smartphones or the technology. It was just like really bringing the internet to everyone's daily lives. And what did we as a industry do with that? Does anyone know? I'm sure you know, all of you know. What did we do with that challenge?
Nothing.
No, not nothing. We did one thing. Yeah, we invented the responsive web. That's a great thing. Don't you think? Okay. I don't think it's great, to be honest. Because the responsive web just did one thing. It took what was the old use case and kind of mashed up to the new devices. So most of the responsive websites you find out there are just a transformation device-wise or screen-wise to the new device, nothing more. But the mobile revolution was so much more than, or is so much more than just new screen sizes. It's about use cases, it's about situations of use, and it's about the impacts that other systems can have. So responsive was more or less like a painkiller. We sold that to the executives on the corporations that have been coming up and asking us, there's that mobile thing going on. What the heck, how should we react to that? And we said, let's do it responsive. Then you can put a tick on your task list, make my platform mobile ready. And so that's a typical painkiller thing we did there. And as with most painkillers, that works for a certain period, then the painkiller fades away, and the pain will remain and come there. But there is even more, of course, with that change. It's this big data thing. You can see from that slide that I'm more like the Star Trek kind of guy than the Star Wars kind of guy. I had a really nice, I heard something nice when I was at the Chemexco last year. There was two executives from I assume, a rather larger country standing at a booth, and they were reading through a product description. And one guy was saying to the other, hey, Marcus, I didn't remember the names, I'm just telling, it's Marcus. Hey, Marcus, is there big data included? And then the other guy went through the flyer and said, yeah, they mentioned it here, big data is included. Okay, then let's go for that one. So it's a typical thing that everyone is talking about big data, but a lot of people do not understand what that means business-wise. And it's not about definition, it's more about the ability to take what's there, technology-wise, and turn it into business. I think that's really the kind of thing that's really important. I have a good example in Switzerland, where they're saying that they want to use weather data, which is available for like 50 years, something like that, and I want to compare that to the book portfolio that has been rented out in libraries. So what can we do with this kind of thing? That's a big data task, to gather that task, to bring the systems together, to do the mashup of the data and get an insight. Maybe we can learn from that data, all that vast of data, that we maybe can steer our sort of portfolio in the libraries better, because we see there is a coincidence between the weather and the books that people rent out, or the amount that people rent out. A lot of companies terribly fail doing big data projects. They're all talking about warehouses and that big servers and memory management and what the heck. But they're not asking, why the hell are we doing that? And that, what could be the direct business results from my big data projects? And in the end, it affects us, or us as the CMS industry, of course, to a high extent, because we are the ones that are providing data, providing content out to the end user again. And there's even more, you know that. They're wearables. Of course, I had to bring that because of that Apple Watch, sure. But there's even more. Think about Google Glasses or other glass-based devices that are used in logistics. I've been talking to a bigger logistics company last week, and I've been telling them that they have a very concrete project where they are going to replace all the touchpads they have in their warehouses by eyewear, and that they are searching for a solution how they can bring the collective list for the goods they have to send out to the eyewear and to find a good mechanism, because it provides a lot of benefits for the guys there working with free hands. That's not the B2C thing, the fancy thing, but there is something going on behind that. And again, it's us having the right technology to step in there, because in the end, that's content as well. And of course, there's even more. Is Jan Hendrik here? Oh, God. Don't you have a experience in these kind of things?
My wife was scared and I exchanged it with a professional version.
Okay, can you tell just in one sentence what this is?
It's a rice cooker or something in which is controlled for an exact temperature for cooking.
Yeah. For doing sous vide?
Yeah. Yeah,
okay. To cook meat in a very, very sophisticated way, as I understood that. Okay, so what I want to symbolize with that is the Internet of Things. We are trying to connect all kind of devices to the internet and make use of it, make benefits of it. And don't ever think that this kind of development is stopping here in Jan Hendrik's kitchen. No, it's going further. It's going to the business.
My version and Wi-Fi.
Great. Yeah, you should tell me definitely more about that. So, what I wanted to show in the last four slides is that there are huge challenges coming in, and there are huge changes going on out there in the way people are using the internet, in the way or what people are expecting from the internet, and the way that corporations are starting to use that technology or the new possibilities to make their business. So, from my point of view, What we knew as content management systems, this text and picture thingy, which we have been dealing, or we are dealing actually today a lot, from my point of view, traditional content is dead. I don't think it's dead in a way that completely dead, but it has just a very small portion of the total content we are going to deal with in the future. And why is that so? And it all boils down to a very, very, very simple thing. It's because users want to make their lives as easy as possible. And by using smartphones, by using internet devices, by having information at their fingertips, they just make their lives easier. That's it. It's not more or less. So now, what's the state of the things today? If I'm talking to executives in rather large, we were dealing with rather large companies, it often looks like that. It's actually taken from a real project we're working on. It's extremely complex, and it takes extremely big efforts to make digital platforms really good, because there are a lot of other systems included, and there's a lot of heritage systems that needs to be included as well, and that often leads to some user experience that's more than questionable. Did everyone of you, or any one of you, try to check in a Swiss flight at Lufthansa, or the other way around? Okay, that's really a pain. It's just very, very awkward to do that, and especially didn't get better with the relaunch of Swiss, even worse. But that's another story. But the point why this is so complicated is exactly because of there have been so much system in the background, and the only way to get that done, at least, is to do it the way they have it there. But it's not something that is used and just helping the business. So often these kind of constellations, although everyone is doing these best efforts to get a great solution, lead to rather, let's say, mediocre solution in the end. And we find ourselves in quite the same way, the same situation like 10 years ago. Like, we had high cost with all that kind of stuff. We lack the flexibility to do business right on the web. All that slows down companies because they cannot really do business. And it's just a fine hassle in the end. So maintaining this digital platform is a tough game. And you see, it's just this slide is just a repetition from when we had some minutes before, like maintaining websites is a tough game. It's just the same situation now, but it's even more painful because users really want to have great solutions from the companies. So have a look at our graph system again. What's happened now is that the end user demand and the adoption of technology is going up in a very steep curve here. Our capability to deliver on that is just going in a normal way again. And I added another graph that's saying the possibility of technology that says that a lot more would be possible. So we are not on the top of the technical development, but we're just not doing more than we're just not doing more than we can, actually. So back then, what we fixed as an industry was that gap here, the expectation and what we could deliver. And of course, that steep thing was the magic we did to our customers. That's why they loved us, because they have all of a sudden, it was really great to work with all these kind of systems. And today, the challenge is even a lot bigger. And from my point of view, I don't see any solution at the horizon, to be honest. The only thing I see here is some sort of a black hole. Have I been able to explain that in a way you part of understand what I mean?
Yes.
Good. Okay, so we're doomed, are we?
The highway to hell.
Highway to hell. So we should seek for retirement as fast as possible, or change the industry, or do something else. I'm saying no, not at all. Because we're still in the place, and we have still very good relations to our customers, and we can still do a lot of business, a lot of interesting work with our customers. And I found, in preparation of that talk, I found a picture of Casper wearing the
Bob the Builder
outfit when he wanted to announce that really now is the time that everyone is getting together and get things going. And this kind, for me, this is exactly the same moment we are in now as an industry, but in particular as the Type 3 community as well. I've been talking a lot about that I think it's now is the moment to step up, to get together again, to get the energy sourced in one direction and really do great things together. So I'm not thinking we're doomed, not as an industry and not as a Type 3 community, not at all. But it's now, the moment is now to act. So what should we do? I have to admit, I'm better in doing the analyst work than doing the solutions. That's a pity sometimes. So I cannot come here with clear concept what to do. I just have like four advices. My first advice would be we should really replace the C in CMS. That doesn't mean, I mean, not the C, literally. I don't have anything against the letter C, but the content. And the content as we know it right now, text, picture. We should get rid of that in our minds and start thinking of content as something that is coming from different sources, that's highly automated, that's data-driven, or that's data. And that text thing, our picture thing, is just a small portion of the whole content we are dealing in our systems. The second advice would be that we really should stop applying cheap fixes. I know that's hard. I have done responsive web projects myself as well, and I failed in persuading customers not to go with responsive but adaptive, or think about more of the use cases and the kind of things that users want to do. I terribly failed as well. And I know it's hard. And it's most of the time, applying the easy fix on these kind of challenges is tempting. But in the end, you're not doing a favor for your customers. So every time you are thinking of what should really be a feature like, I can only advise to everyone that you should have a look at the end user demand first. That means, what is the end user wanting to do? And then, having that identified, going back and elaborate together with the customers, what is that a requirement we can deal with or can't we deal with it? Really to focus on the solution that helps the end user doing his stuff. And then derive features from that requirements. I mean, this is the basics, but we're not doing that. Most of the times, we are thinking, what is the customer writing down in this RFP? And we're just doing some stuff he is writing there. And in the end, we are saying, we knew that it's not going to work, like what he wanted to do on the web. I mean, so often this is the case. That's my third advice. And my last advice is a very simple one, and I heard in another talk that was mentioned yesterday, is just aim for disruption. That means go really for the big picture. Don't be afraid to change things in a big way, and really think big if you do make your moves in a project, product-wise, all these kind of things. Because I'm totally convinced we are not going to exist in such an extent as we do now as an industry in the upcoming years if we're just applying the cheap little things and we just continue like we did here. And I don't have more advices, to be honest. It's just something I wanted to say. That's why we needed the big shift. Some principles you could apply that we are trying at AOE or the other stuff I'm trying to do in my life in the industry is doing these kind of things, trying to live by that, the better or the worse. Who is ahead if you look at competition? And that's my last section of the talk today. And I've been screening the market for quite 6-7 years now, intensively. I even wrote a master paper on that, on the CMS market. And I think the good thing is that no one is really ahead. Really no one. The only company that, from my point of view, has some solutions for customers is Big Blue. Maybe you know some of their solutions they have. It's quite a stack of components big companies can use to really deliver great, great solutions. For our universe, I think this is not really a threat because the IBM solutions, they're very pricey and almost none of our customers can really afford to paying that. But the general concept they have behind their solutions is exactly going into the right direction. And from my point of view, what is really key is the open sourcing. So if someone is coming with a great software stack to handle all those problems in future, and it will be open source, he will quite overrule us all. That will be just a wave coming in. And we can just be happy that no one ever did so far, because the party was so good, there was no reason to do really the great and new things. So that was all about my ideas, my thoughts about the shift we need in the CMS industry. And I hope you maybe take some of these ideas with you and use that in your daily work and in your talks to your customers. And hopefully we see that a lot of new solutions out there, better solutions out there. I know most of you are working very hard to get things done and get things better for Type 3 especially. And I think that's really way to go. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Alain.
Thank you.
Any questions? There is a coffee break.